He's in New York, and John Gunderson and John Wood are in studio today. They're going to be co-hosting, and we were talking about Silence of the Lambs, one of the greatest movies ever, just because it's so up and down with weirdness and funny stuff that most people wouldn't find funny, but I know these two will find funny. We were talking about some of the weird scenes in that movie, and John Wood actually does a good Buffalo Bill.
That's the best scene of all time. It's one of the top five scenes, I think, in any movie ever.
I think if you sneak up on anyone, you should use that voice. Do you guys ever order from like a restaurant with a different voice?
Oh, yeah. I can't help it.
That's the voice I would do. Telemarketers, if they call, I just answer the phone. Like
very
that.
Immature.
Sorry.
How you guys been?
Good, man. Yeah. Good. Real good.
Yeah.
How come you don't age?
I do.
No,
I
you
feel
don't.
It. You look barely the same get up in the morning. Time. I know that's what a lot of people say, but I don't feel it.
Yeah?
I don't feel it.
Well, I say that about the well, actually, I'm not even going to say that. I'm not going to say what. Oh, okay. Yeah. Have to really monitor that.
Danny, the other two
good
reads.
Good genes, John. You got good genes.
The other two reads. Do we need to do them by Friday?
We need to do them by the end of the day Friday.
All right.
We're up in 30.
Up in 30 seconds. Where's George at? He forgot the
it's
show.
It's just us today. It's just us today.
And now it's
we can make it happen.
About 3 years away from 40. This is killing me. Can't believe it's going by so quick.
Oh Jesus. You guys are coming up in 10. You guys ready?
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Here we go. See you on the other side.
This is your captain speaking. We are making our descent into Las Vegas McCarran Airport. On behalf of our crew, we'd like to thank you for flying MMAjunkie Airlines. Now please fasten your seatbelts and put your tray tables in your upright position because the descent is going to be a little bit bumpy.
All right, Junkie Nation, it's time to roll, baby, on MMAjunkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Go. This is what we do and why we do it, baby. All night long. We rollin'! Yes!
The MMA Junkie Radio revolution is upon us.
Can you dig it?
There's no escape.
No escape.
Through the vast frontier of cyberspace and through a sea of stars in outer space.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
We've solidified our combat communication stranglehold.
We are controlling transmission.
With the use of MMA Junkie Radio and Sirius XM satellite radio technology.
MMA Junkie Radio. Commence transmission.
Live from MMA Junkie Radio HQ in the fight capital of the world. Las Vegas, Nevada. Here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Go.
From the fight capital of the world inside the beautiful Mandalay Bay Racing Sportsbook, you are listening to the MMA Junkie Radio Show. I'm George, that's Goes. Back east, it's Danny. Sitting to our far right is John Wood, the head coach of Syndicate MMA, former MMA and UFC superstar John Gunderson. To my immediate right, what's up, guys?
What up?
What's up, brother?
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Been a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Think of what I see you at, Best Buy last or something
Best
like
Buy.
That?
Best
Buy. Hey, Best Buy is like a hub for MMA, right?
You run into a lot of people there. When did you start working there?
About 6 months ago. Oh,
good for you.
John fed me stock a good scoop that day, but I had to keep chill on it, you know? But it turned out to be one of the biggest scoops I've ever heard.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Ever?
Ever.
Do tell.
Well, has it passed yet?
Well, it was almost 2 years ago. I don't know.
Is there a statute?
You don't remember?
I don't remember.
We'll discuss it in the commercial. You give me permission, I'll do it.
Long-term memory loss.
Was it about Reebok?
No. It was about a UFC champion who gets in trouble a lot.
Oh,
okay. Ooh. Oh, I know what this is. Okay. Yeah. But I thought you were going to say, like, get the 4K TV or something like that.
Oh, no.
That's what I thought you were talking about.
Get the extended warranty.
Dude, I hate those. I hate when you purchase a car, a camera, a TV. As soon as you're down, they go, follow me into this other room where we'll talk about if it should break down.
It's going to break.
This new product we just sold you on, with the latest technology, it could break down. You could be fucked. Here we go. Another 200.
Yeah.
Hate it.
Just call the Geek Squad.
Never done.
You just got back from international travel, right?
Just got back from Korea this week. Yep.
All right. Yeah. Not north, just to be clear.
No, I don't think so. I couldn't. I mean, honestly, I couldn't tell you. They told me it was south, so I think that's where I was.
As long as there was sunshine and it wasn't gloomy, yeah, and people would look like they had been living life.
Yeah, I totally was expecting something different. South Korea is very, very nice, actually. It's mm-hmm. like a kind of just like New York.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, with a lot more Asian people.
Did you go to the capital, Seoul?
Yeah, that's where we were at. It was a beautiful city, actually. I was really, really surprised. I did not expect that to be going. You hear all the stuff on the news and all that kind of things, and you think of like, oh, it's going to be a war-torn dictator type of country, but obviously South Korea is completely different than that. So, yeah, it was very, very nice. Very, very nice.
What's the scene like for MMA in terms of, like, are there a lot of gym? I mean, we know some of the fighters that have come over and succeeded, but, you know, are there more coming? Are there a lot of gyms filling up?
There's a lot of little small gyms over there. You know, probably most of them, I'd say, the training rooms that we saw were maybe the size of this room here. There's nothing big over there like that, but there's a lot of they I'll tell you what, they pack that room in with 20 people, you know, so it's pretty crazy. But there's a lot of I think up and coming fighters that are coming over there. There's a new show. We were just over there for Battlefield FC, Korean promotion that they're trying to start and get going over there, which was the production of the show was phenomenal. It was like a Pride level show. It was crazy. The fire, everything, the setup was amazing. So I know they're trying to get some stuff going on over there, which would be cool.
They have great athletes.
Yeah.
I follow soccer, and we've had a couple Korean players on the Manchester United side over the years in the Olympics. A lot of them have done well in boxing. Mm-hmm. Now we're seeing some in MMA. But even if you look at the medal count, they just do well across all sports platforms.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I think there's going to be an influx of Korean fighters, more of them.
Yeah, I mean, I think with Korean Zombie obviously kind of getting the headlines and stuff, I think that's bringing more of the, you know, Korean fighters to the forefront. And they're definitely hyped about MMA over there. Mm-hmm. That's something that they're really trying to push and get into that country. And do some promotion. So I think you'll probably see a couple more promotions pop up over there, you know, promoting Korean fighters and stuff. So over the next year or two, I'm sure you'll see a lot of talent come out from there.
Arguably, it could be, as far as if you rank the Asian countries and their successes right now, Korea could be one, two, Japan. For many years, it was one, Japan.
Could be.
And then whoever else, distant second. But Choi, you know, he brought up Zombie. John brought up Zombie. There's Choi, the guy that battled Cub Swanson. Mm-hmm. There's both
Stun guns.
There's the stun gun version, and what's the other guy's called? Same name, but.
What do you mean?
Not Do Hoo Lim. Wait. Who did we just say? Stun gun. But he's got another. There's the miniature version. What's his name? He's got a nickname.
Oh. Shit. I don't remember his nickname.
Okay. Well, anyway, there's some really solid
that's
fighters.
A good crop. Mm-hmm.
Right. And I would think that you know China's. It's got to come. I'm telling you, the Chinese fighters are going to show up as well.
Yeah.
It's a huge country, huge population, but they're also athletes too.
They've started doing a lot of shows. You have Kunlun over there. Really, they're doing like weekly shows. You've got a lot of shows popping up over in China
too. And
there's
money down there
too. We're getting a lot of calls. Over the last 6 months, I've had a lot of calls from Chinese promotions trying to get our fighters to go over there and stuff. So it is definitely growing over there too.
John, what's the latest? John Gunderson, what's the latest with you? Are you still doing any soccer coaching, by the way?
No. Are you allowed to now?
Yeah, no.
Uh-oh, are you that guy on the sideline?
No, I haven't been in a couple years.
I'll check YouTube, man. Did something go down? You might as well share it now.
Sports,
yeah,
man.
I got into a little fight a few years ago, but.
Did you really?
Yeah.
What happened, man? You know I love to hear the street fight stories.
Oh, it was like 4 years ago.
It wasn't that long ago.
Yeah, it was. It was like 4 years ago. And one of the parents was saying something to my kid, and I got into it, and he came running over and took a swing at me. So.
Oh, wow. What? Okay, so that guy initiated.
Yeah.
Then. All right.
Yep.
He did not know? He did not recognize?
No. And then his buddies tried to jump in, and that was it. And then I actually ended up.
Oh, so it was multiple attackers against you.
I ended up getting suspended from going to the games for the rest of the season, which was only like.
So you were out of line. You were out of line for
we both
defending your
we
young
both
daughter?
Got suspended.
That seems bizarre.
We live in a stupid world.
So.
Don't we?
So then I had a hearing with the like the president of the soccer league, and then I ended up becoming friends with him, and I actually hold pads for him every once in a while, and my daughter's actually got moved up, and
he was impressed by his performance on the soccer field.
Has the suspension been lifted?
Oh yeah,
okay.
It was like I said, it was 4 years ago.
But still, I thought they'd
be. And now they're a lot more serious with it, and I just sit there and I watch because they said if I get in trouble again, that's it, and it's pretty serious. So. Well,
what's the explanation, though? I mean, you're just defending yourself.
They tried to tell me it was the first time they've canceled a game in like 14 years because of a fight. So, I mean, I don't know. I don't believe it, but whatever. It is what it is. It was something that happened, so now I just sit there and I watch, and I let the other parents get crazy.
I would almost show up with no attorney thinking, this is a slam dunk. Mm-hmm. All right, what do you have to say for yourself? Well, this guy said something derogatory towards my daughter, and then I chirped back, and then multiple people tried to jump me. What do you want me to do?
Yeah.
Right? I mean, I'm not some clown here that's just going to get taken advantage of.
Did the other parents come to your offense and at least have, like, a John Gunderson fathead every game just to piss people off?
They actually did stick up for me, so it was pretty cool. Yeah. Hmm. And I got to come back, and then my daughter got moved off the team.
That was John's last fight, his retirement fight.
My daughter got moved off the team and actually got moved up into the club league that they own, and it's all.
All right, we're this far in. At least describe the fight. So the guy swung and missed, and
I just took him down real quick.
All right, and you held him down, and
nah, I choked him. Real quick.
Oh, okay,
peacefully held him down.
I choked him, and then someone else was
took his back,
tried to kick me. They just guillotined him real quick, and someone else tried to choke me, and I just took him down, and then a bunch of people got involved, and that was it. Mm-hmm. I stood up and walked off.
Wow.
Nothing big.
Did he go out?
No.
Okay.
No.
That's crazy. Mm-hmm. You know, John, you should know better, though, right? I mean, I haven't had my fair share, that's for sure, but going to the ground with multiple attackers is probably not a good idea.
Because
that's
care.
You know, yeah, people whatever. Start pride rules, kicking your head and all that.
He's not current on his Krav Maga techniques right now.
I saw that. The gym started that about 3 years ago, right?
Yes. About
2 years ago?
A year and a half, 2 years ago, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I was looking over to see, you know, everything you guys are offering and it's stuck around.
Yeah, we actually it's huge. It's one of our biggest programs. We have a huge Krav Maga program. Nomad Krav Maga runs a great self-defense systems out of. They have their own mat space, own area back there. And you know, it's for the masses. Not everybody wants to be a fighter. Not everybody wants to, you know, some people are intimidated by MMA and, you know, some people need to learn how to fight on a soccer field. So,
you got no problem, bro.
Yeah, you know, could have gone a lot better for you. But, yeah, so we brought that in. These guys have been doing a great job, and it's awesome. It's been a great program.
Explain, I guess, update us on why Krav Maga – just some techniques won't work in MMA, and why maybe a couple have slipped in that maybe we're just not noticing to the naked eye.
Well, I mean, Krav Maga is more of a combination of a lot of just different martial arts and stuff, just like anything else. And the reason a lot of it won't work is half the
bullshit.
Shit would be illegal. You know, like you ain't poking somebody in the eye. And I mean, a lot of I actually did Krav Maga for several years when I was younger. And knock it off. A lot of it's good, man. I mean, it's just teaching, like I said, people good, clean self-defense, you know, techniques and repetition of how to get out of a situation. They do a lot of like live, you know, chaotic kind of drilling that will somewhat prepare somebody to do that. But mm-hmm. I mean, there's just certain things in fighting is, you know, MMA is just a whole different breed and different thing. So, you know, there's a big difference between self-defense. There is a lot of things they use. They use a lot of our techniques in their system. But it's, you know, it's more geared, like I said, for the masses of making people aware of a situation more so of getting ready to, you know, go into a professional fight and defend themselves that way. Mm-hmm.
The good thing about it is the head instructor that teaches it actually takes the MMA classes is very up into all the new techniques in Syndicate and really wants to expand his horizons. And he's a great instructor. Mm-hmm. He really is.
Yeah, he comes into jiu-jitsu. And that's one thing I would say that differs our guys from others is he's in there constantly taking classes. He's, you know, he's highly certified in his techniques and things. But he's in, you know, in taking what he can take out of our mixed martial arts, you know, experiences and things and adding that and applying it and kind of evolving it. So it's pretty cool.
Yeah, hats off, man. A few years ago, my girlfriend used to take – you guys had a free class for women, self-defense, mm-hmm. taught by Casey.
Yeah, yeah.
It was like
great instructor.
12, 15 weeks, and he just focused on different things, you know, what a woman may encounter.
Sure.
You know, a couple dozen ladies would show up every week and learn something and take something and just hold on to it because you just never know, man. It's crazy times that we live in.
Yeah, it's crazy. You got people fighting on soccer fields and kids games and things like that. It's this is rough, you know.
You gotta defend yourself.
Yeah.
All right, so update us, please, on what's next. Like, let's go through a timeline of who's fighting maybe the end of this month, April, May, for the Syndicate MMA Pro Team. Or amateurs as well.
Well, anything else? I mean, first off, does Best Buy have any good sales coming up or anything like that? Gunderson? Yeah. Anything we need to know? Black Friday?
Prepare. You're about, what, 8 months away?
We got lots of stuff coming up. I mean, one of our teams, we got a lot of up-and-coming fighters and a lot of younger guys that are really blossoming. Let's see. As far as UFC, we're looking Khalil Roundtree will be back up soon. Don't have a definitive date. JB Moyle coming up. Looking, you know, Pyle's still in the mix. We'll see what he's got coming up. This weekend we have Roxanne Modafferi is going out to Fusion fight in Montana for a title fight. She's fighting for a title. Against some tough Brazilian girl. I forget the name, but she's got a title fight. Serena De Jesus also has a title fight on the same card. It's an all-women's card out in, like I said, Fusion Fight in Montana. Good show, good little promotion. So they're main eventing that. So she's taking a kind of a little bit of a break between – she'll have that, and then she'll jump right back into Invicta. They were kind enough to let us, you know, get in and take a they're pretty good about letting us take fights in between if
right.
So that the fighters don't have any downtime. So that's coming up this weekend. And then, we got a pretty big run. I got Corey Hendricks coming up, just signed with ACB, a Russian promotion. So
yep.
He's going out to we're going out to St. Petersburg, Russia. So that'll be it.
Damn, you're logging the miles.
Yeah, and then I'm going back to Korea. It looks like they want to take Korea. Really was happy with Jessica Rose Clark, Jessie Jess. So they're going to sign her. So she'll have another one in May. So I'll be doing Korea and Russia in the same month. Woo! Adam Aquaviva, another one of their young studs coming up. He's got a big fight up in Denver in the Sparta Combat League.
Mm-hmm.
He's a World Series fighter, and he's going out to do that. We got a lot of stuff coming up. Mm-hmm. I mean, every month we got two or three fights every month. So,
John, you're the assistant head coach?
No, I'm just in there. I help out when I can. Now I'm working so much at the bar, so I have a couple days off Wednesday and Thursday. And if John's out of town, and Tom's actually Lawler,
right.
Assistant coach. But if they're out of town and they need someone to cover, I help out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but I'm so busy. I got so much going on. That, like I said, both of my girls play soccer, and it really time consumes me. We have it every day that we're working out except for Friday, and sometimes we're traveling. So I try to help out as much as I can. But at this point in time, I really just trying to train people in the industry.
Mm-hmm.
And
one-on-one?
Yeah, a little one-on-one. Then I help out John and Tom when I can.
He's in there every day. Mm-hmm. He's in there every day. Still a big part of the family.
Like Norm at Cheers, just can't get rid of him?
Pretty much.
Yeah, I had to go into the 80s there for an example. John, when we last chatted, you were working at Hakkasan, but catching up through social media and things like that. Now are you at Omnia and Jewel, or where are you?
So I went from Hakkasan, then I opened up Omnia, and then I decided, you know, I didn't want to be a busser anymore. I mean, it was great money, but it just wasn't for me. I wanted to bartend, and I went to the school and got my certification, and they opened up a new gaming bar inside the MGM called Level Up, and I opened that place. So I'm over there now and
awesome.
Working. It's union. I got a day shift. It's simple. It's easy. I make a few margaritas and Bloody Marys and give directions. That's all I do. So it's
Level
simple.
What?
It's called Level Up.
Level Up. Where's that at?
It's inside the MGM right outside of Hakkasan. Where the
Yeah. We've had lunch
Cafe
there, right?
Used to
okay,
be.
I just couldn't remember.
It's really big. It's a nice little spot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, where they have the open workouts. Kind of like in that area, right? When they used to go there.
Yes.
They've been at T-Mobile so much lately. But
exactly.
All right, cool.
It's a cool little spot. I like it.
And bartending's lucrative?
Yeah, it's all, yeah. Yep.
Nice.
Thankfully, right. Though, every like 3 weeks he comes in. I want to get a fight. I'm going to fight.
Yeah,
he's had six comebacks yet in the last
Yeah, and then I trained once, and I'm
Oh, this is stupid.
Well, last I saw, we're pushing 2.5 years since your last fight, right?
Yep.
Okay. Did it ever get close to a comeback?
I mean, I would still fight if the right fight presented itself.
The right opponent, the right money, a combo of both, or
the
is there something
really
else
doesn't matter
for?
To me. It's the fight that matters.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've been in talks with a guy from the soccer field to see if we can actually get. Promotion to pick that up, maybe. Yeah. We're gonna see it. Do it legit.
What halftime? What, at least 15 minutes, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
I've only got 5 minutes in me.
Can I share my favorite part of Syndicate?
Sure.
I follow them on Instagram, and when it's someone's birthday, Man, I lose my shit. It's so funny, George. So I want to show you. So what they do is they all line up. And
oh, this
like,
isn't even a good one. Khalil took it like a champ. He took it way too good.
Look at the people in line to sock this dude up.
That's how sick they are.
They were literally afraid of, I think, afraid of Khalil.
Some of them are nice, and then some of them are brutal.
So you guys are...
Go to his brother if you can find
Donovan
Freeloos. His brother.
You guys are all being big pussies.
Oh!
He's going to remember that.
Is he taking mental notes right now, or
he pretty much drops every single buddy that he hits in the body when it's birthday time. So I think they were all.
Oh. So you might as well get yours in because he's dropping you,
that's
right?
That's what I was saying. I mean,
and some of them have like mean walk-ups where you think it's going to be bad, but then it's light, and then some of them are backwards.
Yeah, I've actually.
We don't want that big
I've
guy
had
hit
to.
You.
Had some. I've had to have some talks with these people.
Oh wait!
Happy birthday!
They're doing.
Did she go twice?
I was gonna say. Do they rotate it, or was it once per?
It's one. You get two shots per everybody one time.
Oh, yeah. So. Yeah, but they do that every birthday, and it's so much fun, man, to watch.
Wow.
I kind of keep a mental note of who jacked who up, and so then I go, okay, it's this dude's turn. He's going to get messed up by this guy.
Oh, yeah. Like, I'd say going back, Adam Aquaviva, he is probably the biggest offender of – he's our 135er, tiny little guy, but he thinks he's a, you know – big bad dude.
He's
but
a scrapper.
Yeah, he is. Super tough kid. He'll be a big show guy soon. But he just waylays everybody. So come his birthday.
Well, what happens if you don't show up on your birthday?
Oh,
is
we just wait.
Two
we'll
times
get you,
worse?
No, or? We'll just get you the next day.
Yeah, okay, we'll, so you we'll remember. You
oh,
write
yeah.
it down.
Yeah, yeah. No. So nobody lets anybody slide now. So if you disappear for 2 weeks, you come in, somebody's got a mental check. You know, they've got it checked off already. Okay, it's your birthday. You're coming in. But it's actually kind of – it's funny. It's become a kind of become a thing. People come in and they're like, hey, it's my birthday. It's like a rites of passage. I'm like, why the fuck would you want to tell anybody that? Like, I did it 1 year, and that was good enough for me. I'm like, nope, I don't hit nobody, and nobody's hitting me.
Are there any negotiations? Does it get you out of it or anything
like
that? No. You're just toast?
It's in. You got to do it. That's just the way it is. So, you know – we haven't had any broken ribs or, you know, busted livers or spleens or anything yet, but it's I'm sure it's going to happen. So at that point in time, we might have to rethink our birthday, how we handle our birthdays. But it's good, clean fun. And what's funny is from posting it, there's like other gyms and other schools that have started picking it up and doing it. Nobody does it quite as fun as we do, but it's kind of a thing that's turned into, so that's cool.
If a bone ever breaks, can I make a suggestion? Have you ever seen that giant slingshot that shoots the giant water balloon?
Yeah.
Can you blast people with those?
I mean, yeah, if you can get one of those set up. Actually, that might work in there. That might work.
I'm just wondering what they do for the belt promotion. If they're doing just for a birthday?
This is the we like cow. You.
Yeah, the belt promotion.
Somebody's you cut off someone's pinky or something like that? I mean, these guys are like the mafia over here.
They whip the shit out of you with the belts and all that stuff. That's old school. So we had to have our thing. You know, we had to get our.
Who's hit you the hardest the one time you did it?
Oof, probably Adam. I mean, Adam's the guy that always rings out. He's always the guy that's trying to sit you down and hurt you. I mean, Khalil is not a softie either. That guy, man. So yeah, it's pretty bad because a lot of guys too. They'll try to. There's certain people that they'll go a little bit lighter on, and certain people that they're gonna try to sit you down. So even the guys that don't hit light after your 10th shot, somebody who ain't got much stank on it still comes in. It all hurts after that.
Mm-hmm. I would imagine like a week leading into your birthday, you're probably like an upstanding gentleman, right?
Right.
Everyone and
exactly
lay that foundation. And as soon as it's over.
Tossing everybody like cold drinks afterwards. Yeah. Maybe come in with that pizza.
Good today, man. You look great out there.
Yeah. How about you, John? John Gunderson, who's...
I've never done it. I won't do it.
Oh, okay.
If you hit me in the stomach, I'm, you know, you were fighting.
So you're just good with the happy birthday? And
yeah.
A wave, a fist bump,
yep.
And that's it?
That's it.
And why is that?
Because I don't like that.
Not even the one time? Nope. Just to see what everyone's talking about.
He's too much of a hothead. You can't, like, even brush up against guns without him posturing up.
I don't like it.
Okay.
Like, if you hit me, I gotta hit you.
So then you also didn't get in the line either.
Nah.
You sat. You just sit out the ritual.
I did to certain people back a few years ago. I did to a couple people. Mm-hmm. But I'm not gonna hit them light either. You know what I mean? Yeah. But they're not hitting me. I'm the coach.
Yeah. Hey, you mentioned Pyle earlier.
We're the coaches.
A lot of people felt like after his last loss, him being north of 40 years old now, that that might be it for him. So are you kind of telling us that he still has fight in him? Has he announced that yet? Or is that maybe his business? We'll leave it alone? Or what can you say on that one? He's a longtime Junkie Radio favorite. We've covered him for a long time.
There's still – I mean, I think his desire to fight is still there.
Okay.
I think that, you know, some of the things that have happened in the last few fights and things have just, you know – stylistically, you fight somebody, they hit you good and hard, and you're gonna, you know, you fall down, whatever. Some things have gone on that I think a lot of those things, a lot of people would have got dropped with some of those shots, and obviously the age and the things that, you know, that starts happening, and you start equating age into the factor and how long he's been to the game, people start questioning and things like that. Ultimately, it's up to him. He has, you know, he's still with the UFC, he's still got a contract, he's still got a lot of fight in him. Still one of the most talented dudes I've ever worked with, rolled with, sparred with, trained with, one of the most knowledgeable guys. So it's just kind of in my personal opinion, do I think he wants to still fight? Absolutely. Do I think he will? More than likely.
Okay.
You know, ultimately that's up to him. He's got a lot of things going, and the guy's got a lot of different facets. He's doing a lot of stunt work, acting,
the fishing too,
you
right?
know, his fishing business is a Fish On Energy company that he's got, his apparel company, and that's doing fantastic. So he's got a lot of things, he's got a lot of things going, a lot of, you know, good stuff past fighting that he can move on to. So at this point in time, it's really if he wants to continue to do it and, you know, take another crack at it, which we all know, and Guns, myself, everybody, it's hard. It's something hard to give up, even when you should or shouldn't, or you get, you know, get on, and even when you don't feel like doing it, when you're, you know, when it becomes miserable to you, it's still one of those things that's super hard to give up.
Okay.
You know.
So what is it that magnetism of the sport, I guess?
I mean, it's you know, fighting itself is probably one of the most primalistic, animalistic, egotistical, narcissistic, like it's everything combined into one, you know, ball, and it's awesome. It's
Do you
fun.
Get that
it's
out of
great.
Every
it's
practice, or it's only on fight night, and then obviously with a win?
I mean, he could tell you the grind going out there and fighting when you got 10, 20 years into it, going out there fighting is that's the easy part. It becomes that's the God, I wish I had, you know, this feeling, or I wish I could have gotten this comfortable with it 10 years ago. But it's the getting into the gym, getting into the grind after you have all the injuries, after you have all your body's banged up, your head's banged, everything hurts. You know, just as a coach, I just completely, you know, I tore my rotator cuff, completely shredded my shoulder 3 weeks ago, you know, doing nothing, just something that's just getting old sucks, you know, and when you get old in this sport, knees, your body, your bones, everything starts to hurt, you know, and it just becomes a grind. It's just like any job, you do it for long enough, whether it's mentally taxing or physically taxing, and that's where it is like the the 6 to 8 week camps become real long. Mm-hmm. So it's you know, going out there and fighting, we still all want that payoff. That's the rush. That's the high. You know, people who haven't fought, you're never going to feel anything like that. When you step into a cage, especially depending on what level it is, you know, in front of thousands of people or millions of people or, you know, on TV, whatever it is, there's nothing you'll ever feel that comes close to that. Skydiving, any of that kind of stuff, it's just the primal rush. It's right. Hard to get over. You know, you chase that high, so to speak.
All right, we'll let you answer in just a sec. We got to take this commercial. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93. We have a couple guests in-house. John Wood on the far right, John Gunderson on my immediate right. Talking MMA, talking Syndicate MMA. And, of course, we'll take your calls at 866-522-2846. We'll be right back. Stay close.
compassion, common sense. These guys have none of that. You listen to them, so you're no better. I am awesome, though. They are gorgeous George and Goes.
All right. You can follow our guests on Twitter. John Wood is Big Wood MMA. John Gunderson, if you tweet him, he'll answer you in about 6 months. He's at John Gunderson 55. Last tweet registered was July of 2016. Been busy, huh?
Yeah, I'm not big on Twitter.
Okay. All right. Also, if you want to call in and chime in on any topic that we have, it's 866-522-2846. John, can you just finish out, John Gunderson, the question that was posed and that John Wood had started on as far as, like, walking away, why it's so difficult?
The rush, the payoff from the fight, realistically, is like no other. It's a high like no other when you – the competition, the – when you complete something that you set out to accomplish – and you get your hand raised, it's a feeling like no other. Mm-hmm.
What's the toughest part? Like, Faber retired about 3 months ago. Pickett retired about close to a week ago. Where's the toughest? You're technically retired about two and a half years ago. Where's that spot where you're just like, oh, man, you miss it, and where you think maybe there's a hump where you just finally accept that it's done?
I don't think I've accepted that it's done yet. I still have in the back of my head I could fight the right fight. You know? Proposed itself, or the right soccer dad said something to me.
Now he's joining in. Fuck it, right? I'm all in the soccer field.
No, but I don't know. I just feel like once you're a fighter, you're always going to be a fighter. I've been fighting since I was 5-6 years old, and I mean, I would fight tomorrow if it didn't take all the medicals and all the other stuff involved and everything else, because I just like it, and it's just a part of me, but... It's not worth it now. Once you get to a certain age and you have I used to fight and go out there, and the feeling when I would walk to the cage or the ring would be, I'm ready to die. Mm-hmm. You know, are you ready to die? Because I'm ready to die. Now I have kids and I have to get up and work the next morning, and if I don't provide for them, how are they going to survive and what are they going to do? So I'm not ready to die.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So it's different. It turns you into a different individual.
In a fighter's career, there's the luck of the draw, there's injuries, there's so many things, matchups that go into someone's career. Looking back now, do you see fighters fighting at the highest levels and look at them and just go, how'd that guy get there? I can take that guy.
I see it all. Every day, I got to admit, every day I see it. But, I mean, you can't be like that because, you know, that's being a hater, and I'm happy for anyone that gets their opportunities. This sport is all about opportunity. There's so many fighters that are so great that'll never make it to the big show because they can't get the opportunity.
Mm-hmm. All right. Another thing I wanted to piggyback on Pickett was, did you both see the fight? Pickett's last fight last weekend?
Yeah, I just saw the results.
Okay. Did you see the finishing sequence?
Yes.
All right. That's what I want to ask you on. Where do you sit on, should he have gotten maybe one more split second, another sequence of engagement, another punch, whatever you want to call it? I felt like we call it the leash, and I have a longer leash as far as giving the athletes that last chance to recover. And then there's others that like to stop it sooner, live to fight another day, safety, all that stuff. I'm okay with the stoppage, but I wish it would have went a little longer, especially seeing Pickett's reaction, which, of course, I'm not the ref. He's got the best spot, and hindsight's 20/20. But where do you sit on that? Like, what did you think of it?
You know, it's a tough call. You're never going to know the right call. I mean, obviously, we see the ones that are – super bad where you're like, oh my god, that got stopped, and that's a reaction of a ref. We're putting another human, there's always human error,
right?
Anytime you have a human in any situation who's in charge of something, that's the risk we run. He's in there. If he gets, you know, the guy gets clipped and his eyes roll back and he sees that for a split second, that's his job to, you know, make that decision. Some are better than others. It's you never know what the ref's looking on. They might be going in there knowing this guy's coming off of a few knockouts, and he might be a little bit more worried about the guy's health, so he's already got it predetermined into his head. If he drops, he's going to stop it. Could it have gone another few seconds? Yeah. You know, the outcome I don't think would have changed at that point in time. But it's tough, man.
But he was up 2-0. So
yeah,
if the clock somehow runs out and he grabs a single.
And that's the thing about MMA is you never know. Yeah,
right.
He could have got dropped. He could have came right up, grabbed a single, held on for, you know, the rest of that round, and probably won.
Yeah.
So it sucks, man. But that's the great thing about the sport is that we have these kind of conversations about something like that. Keeps us interested. It keeps it unpredictable. Does it suck for the fighter? Absolutely.
I love the unpredictability. Yeah. And I've always said it from day one, the controversy of the sport will help it grow.
Yeah.
It's just that it's going to be at someone's expense. Yeah. The guy that's pissed off, why'd you stop it so soon? You know,
absolutely.
Whatever. But
absolutely.
Guns, where do you sit on the stoppages?
Basically, what you just said.
Let them go a little longer?
I agree. Yeah. I agree. Let them go a little longer. I can see why they do it, because health and safety, and, you know, they're trying to make sure that nothing bad happens. So, you know, the sport doesn't get have to deal with any of the stuff they've had to deal with in the past. Mm-hmm. So I can understand the safety of the fighters is number one, but it is a fight. Like, once they're down and they're out, or they can't move anymore, or they're not fighting, intelligently defending themselves, then stop the fight. Mm-hmm. But you got to give them a chance to react. You have to give them a chance to react.
All right, let's take some calls. Jersey Mike starting things off. What's up, Mike? How you doing?
What's going on? How you guys doing?
Good, man.
What up?
I just have a quick question for the Johns, and I'll take it off air. I just wanted to get your guys' thoughts on the state of weight cutting today in MMA, and I was wondering if you guys have ever seen, whether it be one of your guys or another guy, have such a bad weight cut and still go through with the fight. And you guys have a good show.
Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, I mean, I've personally experienced it myself and fighters. It's happened a lot. It's gotten a lot better over the years with techniques and how to improve doing it better. But, yes, it's an extremely dangerous sport, and I still see guys cut huge amounts of weight. I have a couple guys that I've had talks to this week even about, hey, maybe we should go up to the next weight class if you can't, you know, especially with a lot of the younger guys. They get into – you know, the youth on their side, they're burning a lot of calories. As you get older, even just, you know, a year or two older, sometimes that changes and guys still try to hold on to that, and it gets really, really dangerous. But, yeah, it is getting better, and they are doing things in the sport to try to improve it, but it is a very dangerous game. The reason everybody does it is because there's always going to be that one guy that, even if you change the rules, he's still going to try to cut weight. He's going to go out there and have success with it. Everybody else is going
to
start doing
it. Wants
to
match it, right?
You know, so... Yeah. The mentality is shifting, and it is something that's becoming more aware and talked about on a regular basis. And I think over the next few years, they will change a lot of things. But it is definitely dangerous, and I've seen some really bad weight cuts, and I've seen some really bad experiences where guys have, you know, passed out, myself included. As I was fighting, I've had horrible, horrible experiences when nobody really knew what to do. You just sat in the sauna for 10 hours in a day and in a suit and sweat it all out and died and didn't rehydrate properly. But yeah, it's a dangerous game, and I do believe we are going to see, you know, some bad things happen over the next few years that will shift it even dramatically more. But yeah, fighters fight under pretty bad circumstances sometimes, and that's part of the gig. You know, we don't get paid. A lot of guys can't. There's a lot of guys where I've seen that wouldn't want to fight, or that have been sick, or that have been dying just from that weight cut. But you can't miss the fight because you need that payday. Mm-hmm. You know, that there's not enough money in the sport to sit back and be safe on some things. There's not enough sport. I've seen guys fight injured, fight, you know, horrible weight cuts, fight with concussions, fight all that stuff. So, it's a bad thing.
One sec, Guns. Guns, you want to answer the question for the caller?
I think the weight cutting needs to be addressed, and I think it will be addressed within the next two
more weight classes?
Years. Yeah, and I think, you know, same-day weigh-ins. Within a certain amount, they'll start doing that.
So, like, if you're a 55er, you weigh in at 56 or 55 if it's a title fight, some sort of a cap, like, you can't be
can't
more than
be
68
more than
70
or
70 or something like that.
Yeah, somewhere around there.
Okay. Goes.
Have you ever had to make an adjustment as a coach based on a bad weight cut? In other words, knowing your guy had a terrible weight cut, maybe the strategy has to change because you're not so sure he can go the whole five rounds. That sort of thing, has that ever come up?
Yeah. I mean, all those situations come up in every aspect of the sport, I believe, because you have 10 different fighters, you're going to have 10 different weight cuts. It's just the way it goes. And each time's a different weight cut and a different battle on its own.
All right, let's talk to Marco in Waco, Texas. What's up, Marco?
Marco from Waco, Roar, Anio Aseo. You guys were killing me. It's Maestro Don Jung Kim and it's Tongan Don Jung Kim. The guys
Dong
you were thinking about.
You know, I was thinking of Julu Lim, the big Korean. But, yeah, I knew one of them was the maestro. Sorry, that's what I was failing, was the maestro and the stun gun. But I knew both guys were Kims, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. How can you forget Maestro fought Marco Polo Reyes in one of the best fights last year, man. Come on, dude.
Come on, man. There's a lot of MMA out there. Plus, I just came off March Madness trying to remember all those fools' names. I'm watching the NFL draft, which team is going to get who, the NBA, whether the Lakers are going to do a free agency, Manchester United. We're shipping guys, to different teams. Wayne Rooney might go to China. Try tying all that in. It's fucking difficult. And plus, I'm old.
I know. I might crow with Baylor, man. I was talking crap about Baylor, and they're on the Sweet 16. Shit. Hey, you guys were talking about, when guys should let it go and stuff. And this is just my opinion, so take it for what it's worth. But I think there is some onerance in the coaches, especially your two guests in there, to try to intervene sometimes and let the fighter know. The fighter is always going to want to fight. But the coach might have to say, hey, it's time to probably hang it up. Famously, Dana White did it for Chuck Liddell. I mean, Joe Rogan did it for Brendan Schaub. And in this day and age, man, we see pro boxers that are punch drunk. And seeing that in football, Junior Seau suffer CTE and blow his heart out with a shotgun. You don't want that, and then think on hindsight 2020, could have I done something and not let this guy get that one punch that probably messed him up for life. We'll let you guys. Catch you guys tomorrow.
Thanks, Marco. What do you say to that, John? I guess
I agree. I agree with that. That there is a point in time where the coach steps in, and I have had that conversation with plenty of people. Sometimes it's not even just about age or time in it. Sometimes people mentally, physically, there's a lot. I've had this conversation quite often, even with young fighters, amateurs. Listen, man, you got too much going on in your life. It's too whatever, too risky to go out there without, half-assed and do it. But there's a lot of responsibility that goes into coaching to look at that. And I've had that conversation with several of my older fighters, or whatever, that you have the talk and you just,
Did you have a long flight? It looked like you tweaked your neck there.
it's good.
That's what happens to get old.
There are better options out there sometimes. Best Buy, Bonds, Albertsons, whatever. But, no, that is I do believe that is a responsibility as a coach, or a coach if you care about your fighters and friends, because most of these people become friends and family after time, that you have to voice your opinion. Mm-hmm. That opinion doesn't always get heard, because it is a definitely thing, but you need to put that out there so it starts, and it will resonate with a fighter after. I've noticed that, you have that talk, it will come back around, and then sometimes you just have to plant the seed and the seed grows, or sometimes, you're wrong. The guys still have more fight in them and whatever, but as a coach, it is, I feel, a responsibility to look out for that.
That's the thing, is ultimately it falls on the fighter, right? You guys give your input, but at the end of the day, if that's what they really want, they'll find another coach. They'll find another gym. They'll find a way to make it happen. It really comes down to the fighter to just trust people. Trust your coach. Sometimes they know you better than yourself.
And guess what? There's a lot of shows out there, too.
Mm-hmm.
China, well, not just China, but Asia is blowing up with shows. The Russians have like 3 or 4 organizations now that are paying decently. Guess what? You dangle a $20,000 payday, $50,000 payday, whatever your bracket is. It's tough to walk away from that, what I mean? Because, like you guys said, it's just, can I get through the camp? Because showing up, I win my fair share of fights. I should be able to take this guy down. I'm in.
Somebody's going to let you fight. If you want to fight, you can go out there and find a fight. That's part of the problem with our sport, too, is that there's a promoter out there that they don't give two shits about you. From the amateurs on up, a lot of promoters just don't care. There are some that do, but they're just going to put on a fight. And if you've had any kind of name, or if you've had any kind of UFC experience, or for God's sakes, isn't Vitor trying to do some Legends League or something with a bunch of – that should be fun. Hell, I'll watch it. But, if you want to fight somebody, there's somebody that'll put it on for you.
It's got to be the right matchup. I'm on the fence on it because IFL did coaches versus coaches. Some turned out okay. Some were like, oh, man, that's not what I remember. And then you get Kimbo and Shamrock, who I had really zero interest in terms of their athletic skills, but they – sorry, not Kimbo. Ken Shamrock and Royce Gracie is what I meant to say. Then you have these two guys who you just felt like they're going to be rivals for till the end, So I guess if they're going to duke it out, I'm in. So I guess it just has to do with the matchup, honestly.
Well, now aren't we possibly looking at Hoyce and Hughes, I hear, is on the
– Yeah. See, now that one right away, I hear it, and I'm like, I'm not interested. Are you?
No. The first one wasn't very competitive at all.
But the thing is, are you going to watch it?
I
Of course you are. Yeah,
I don't know. I'm not sure. I'll tell you why, John.
This says MMA junkie.
I get it.
You don't have a
choice.
You're
going to watch it. There's no.
There's something in you that will make you watch it.
I get it. But see, there's stuff like, for example, Tough Enough. We'll use Tough Enough. We all know what Tough Enough is. If Tough Enough is happening, I'll drive downtown and I'll just read the result on Hoist and Hughes, all right? Mm-hmm. And then there's my other likings of sports or just my social time, because we're getting close to our 10-year anniversary. I'm trying to figure out, like, now what means a lot to us and what is worth covering and what isn't. You have to pick your spots. Otherwise, every fucking weekend we're not going to do shit. You know what I mean?
You don't want to be that guy that missed out. You never
on
know.
On Gracie and Hughes?
You just never know, yeah, man.
The first one was horrific.
It was.
The first one was horrific, though.
The last one.
I actually picked Gracie going, oh, he's got it. Watch this, you know? And then when Hughes ran through, I'm like, what was I thinking? What was I thinking? Yeah.
But, I mean, how can you not think Hoist has a chance after his last performance? Come on.
He's got striking.
Yeah. All right, we better take this last break. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM, March 93. Also want to let you know that UFC bantamweight Valentina Shevchenko will be calling in the second hour. We'll see the when and where, because we already know who. It'll be her and Amanda Nunes for that UFC 135-pound strap. Just got to fill in the blanks. We'll be right back.
They taught Andy Griffith how to whistle. Here are Gorgeous George and Goes.
All right, for more information on the Syndicate Gym in Las Vegas, it's syndicatemmavegas.com, 702-838-8008. They also have a Twitter page. If you want to follow them there, it's twitter.com/syndicatemma. They offer Muay Thai, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, a kids program, Nomad Krav Maga, like we mentioned earlier, Syndafit, and CrossFit. Now, it's been a few years since I've been in there, but they don't have – is this the power lifters in the back, or CrossFit separate from that?
No, we did a whole new fitness center in the back.
Oh, cool.
We got a whole CrossFit big rig back there with, I think, 10 squat rack stations, deadlifts, all that stuff. Added a bunch of new weight equipment. Cleaned the place up. Cut a lot of good stuff.
Chaz Mulkey's Muay Thai class was one of my favorites to watch, man. Mm-hmm. It would just be, like, experts, young people – and he's just got like good spirit, good energy. And you could tell a lot of people were like, you know, learning skills but dropping weight.
Yeah.
So kudos on that. And then the kids would pile in. It was kind of cute to watch the kids come in around that time as well.
Yeah.
So congrats on that gym. Well established here the last 5 years now in that spot on Warm Springs,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, we've been around. I've had that gym for 13 years. Name's changed.
Well, I meant on that spot,
yeah,
exactly.
We've been at that location for, going on 5 years, and it's been doing really well. It's getting better every year.
Massive, too. You know, it's pretty huge over there.
About 17,000 square feet, so... Mm-hmm.
One more question for each of you. John Gunderson, your daughter, what did she think of what happened at the soccer field? Like, at the end of the day, was it, hey, Dad, that was cool? Or, Daddy, you know, I wish you wouldn't have done that. Where did she sit on that?
I mean, she had my back. She was my kid, right? So okay, it was cool. So long ago, and then she was getting yelled at by the parents, so she understood.
She understood.
Sticking up for my kid.
All right. Nah,
so
nice.
It wasn't too big. She's used to it by now.
And, John Wood, one more question for you. Hopefully this doesn't come off wrong, but the one thing I've heard about Syndicate is – the fighters there they kind of don't do the Vegas circuit. Is that accurate?
Yeah,
that's what you prefer, right?
Yeah, I mean, right. Most of my fighters are homegrown from amateur on up, and we build a, you know, real tight team. We're a pretty good family there. It's not that they don't have the option to. I promote not to. I believe that we have the best, you know, situation for everything. We've got great jiu-jitsu, striking, wrestling, conditioning, everything there. So I think sometimes it gets lost in the shuffle when guys are going too many places and have too many coaches and things, so I try to kind of keep a tighter knit on that, but that is definitely something that I promote.
Mm-hmm. And then lastly, where do you feel we'll have to make this quick, we only have a minute.
Sure.
Left women's MMA, we discussed this off the air, but I just want to get your thoughts. Has it been fun taking the ladies in and, you know, coaching them as coaching the male? Like,
absolutely. I mean, women's I treat them pretty much the same way. It's a little different dynamic. You have to do some things different, but I expect all my women to do the same things that any fighter does. I look at a fighter as a fighter. Mm-hmm. The sport's growing, and so their division and things is coming out and becoming quite popular. So I'm on board with it. I have a lot of women fighters, and you know, and I'm supportive of it.
You have anything going on in the gym here in the next few weeks you'd like to promote, or is business as usual?
Just business as usual, man.
Okay. Cool. So follow John Wood on Twitter at John Wood MMA. Follow John Gunderson on Twitter at John Gunderson 55. I don't know if he'll get in there and give you a reply or not, but thanks guys for stopping by.
Thanks for having
co-hosting,
us.
Hanging out. And again, congrats on the success of the gym and
appreciate
your
it.
Daughter, man. Sounds like big days ahead.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so.
For her.
I think so.
Yeah. Awesome. All right, guys. All right. So we're going to take this break. It's a commercial followed by a sports update. And then when we come back, we'll be talking to Valentina Bullet Shevchenko. See if we can fill in some of those details about our possible matchup versus Amanda Nunes for that UFC 135-pound belt. Stay close. Las Vegas turning day into night time. All right, here we go. It's the second hour of the MMA Junkie Radio Show. Big thanks to John Gunderson and John Wood for stopping by. John Wood, the head coach over at Syndicate MMA, one of the huge gyms here in Las Vegas. He's been doing it for a while. And what I like is, I don't know if you remember when he did it last time, goes, it was a few years ago. And I don't have too much interaction with him. I just see him at the Tough Enoughs, kind of a head nod or a wave or a fist bump. But he's really grown into that head coach job. Like, if you watch something, if you're a reader of, you know, someone's personality and body language, you can tell there's a lot of confidence there in his answers. And so he's becoming a cap. Well, he is the captain of that ship. But definitely, you know what? What comes along with that is like the respect from your students, mm-hmm, and your fighters. And so I like that growth.
He has a very good balance of being able to joke with the students and mess around, but when it comes to training and strategy, they respect him very much.
Yeah. And then and I also want to thank John Gunderson. It was his idea. You know, he came to us, and so he actually helped get us John Wood, and it was good to catch up with him, and so happy for him and also mutual friend Rob Cardenas. Apparently their daughters play together or in the same league, and these chicks, man, looks like they may be getting scholarship offers.
Yeah, it's very different now, man, the way they play, the club level and all that.
So they got some skills.
That. So Gunderson got Wood?
Yeah, you could say that, yeah. Also, for tomorrow, our co-host for the day will be, take a guess, guys, I'll give you three guesses.
Quentin Rampage Jackson.
No, he'll be on Monday's show. He's calling in.
Boss Rudin.
No, he was on yesterday's show.
Randy Couture.
No. No. Think the opposite sex.
Oh, Misha Tate.
No. The lovely and talented Megan O'Leary will be co-hosting tomorrow. So she of UFC and Fox Sports, and also Joseph Benavidez, much better half. Sorry, Joseph, don't mean to disrespect you like that, but it's true. I thought we had connected with Valentina Shevchenko, but Danny, did we strike out? Should I send her a text, or are you working on that?
I was going to give her a minute and then try back, but yeah, it rang once and then went right to voicemail. So I don't know what that means.
Maybe that happened to me yesterday. That's pain on my mind.
It could be. It could be like, well, no, it's... I think she's in the central time zone, so it's not like you can say she just woke up or nothing like that. But all right, we'll try it one more time, and then you let me know, and then if we have to give her a nudge, we'll give her a nudge. Valentina Shevchenko, of course, the number two ranked bantamweight in the world in the USA Today Sports and MMA Junkie rankings, number one being Amanda Nunes. We go one being the champ, two is the, I guess you could call it the number one contender or whatever. The UFC's rankings are different where – you may hear that she's the number one ranked fighter there, and then, of course, they have their champions. I don't like that too much.
Yeah, it's kind
of. I just like number one is your champion, and that's that. Because if somebody were to go, oh, she's the number one fighter in the bantamweight division right there, and you walk away, then the other person would go saying, I met the number one fighter in the bantamweight division. You're kind of – I think you're more people will assume that that was the champion, right?
I think it's half and half. I've seen
really?
A lot. Because I could see somebody go, oh, okay, who's the champ?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Well, like in college football, if who won it this year? Clemson, right? Mm-hmm. So if I go, who was the number one team in college football? Most people will go, Clemson. Did you mean the number one team or the champion? Like, I don't
– Okay.
I've never gotten that confusion. And that's when I start thinking of rankings, I always go to college football mostly first because that's where it all started for me.
Can I say something real quick?
Sure.
Shout-outs and prayers to our good friend Jim Ross, a good friend of the show. He lost his wife yesterday, and Jim Ross is just, I can go on and on about how great of a person this guy is, and we're just so devastated that he has to go through this, and we just want you to know, buddy, that you're in our thoughts and prayers, and I know this is a tough time for you, and I hope you can get through this with all the help of all your friends and family.
Most definitely. I got to meet her, actually, goes, I don't know if you were with me or not, it was one of the boxing events in downtown Las Vegas, and knockout at the D. Once the fights were over, everybody leaves the downtown open air, you know, arena, and heads over to the host hotel, the D. And so while we were there, he had co-hosted here, and so it was a quick hello and t- talked about the show, and in that process, he introduced me to his wife, Jen. Very nice lady. And she's the one that actually picked out the shoes that he's rocking that I love, the Ferragamos. I'm a big fan of the Ferragamo brand. And, well, yeah, man, that's, you know, unexpected. She had an accident. Can we say a few days ago? How long ago was it?
Yeah, last weekend? It was 2 days ago.
This past weekend, okay. And she got hit. You know, she was riding a Vespa, and she got hit, and there was some complications. And according to Jim on his social media, they read her last rites, and she passed yesterday. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, our thoughts and prayers are with Jim Ross, their family and friends. Sorry for your loss. May she rest in peace. Okay, so I got the word from Danny. We have not been able to connect, but I have heard from her camp, and I think they're just looking to get to a better spot, Danny. As far as the connection, they're just in a spot where they're not able to get good coverage. So give it a few minutes and then do it again, but they are aware that you're trying to call.
Cool.
All right. In the meantime, you are more than welcome to call in 866-522-2846. Talk about anything you want, including, of course, probably some of the big news of this past week, and that's we are getting much closer to McGregor versus Mayweather. I'd like to know where most people sit on that. Excited? You over it? You going to watch it? Well, how much would you pay? There's a good question. I think a lot of us, if it's free, you'd watch it.
Yeah, of course.
It's the problem whether it's 100 or 50 where you have your limits. But make no mistake, if this thing was free, I'm pretty sure even the biggest hater of that matchup would watch it. So that's what cuts us off. That's where the turnoff is. When you say McGregor versus Mayweather, man, I ain't watching that bullshit. Mm-hmm. And then someone taps you on the shoulder. Really? I'm barbecuing? Come on over. Everyone's coming over. And you start thinking, wait a minute, this is for free? Yeah, sure. I guess I'll watch it one way or another. But because it isn't, and it starts turning into, is it worth my dollars? Is it worth my time? I think that's where the cutoff is. Where's your cutoff? You're just the loneliest guy in the world. You pay your own bills. You don't, you know, you're not social. You don't mooch. You don't steal. What's your limit on what you would pay for that fight?
If I'm and just you have no plans by myself?
Night. Yeah, there's no opposition of a big game or another fight promotion. That's just the only game in town.
Maybe $29.99.
They gotcha.
Even then, yeah, I don't want to be that guy. If I'm going to watch that fight, I'm going to watch it with a bunch of people because we all chipped in. Because I just don't see it as being a competitive matchup.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my cutoff.
I mean, would you want Conor to knock out Mayweather, by the way? You know, go MMA? Or
yeah.
Or do you feel like it just shouldn't be that the greatest boxer on earth got clipped like that? Like, there's something against, you know, I guess what boxing stands for. That just shouldn't happen. And you are a boxing fan, so there's nothing wrong with also standing up for boxing on some occasions either.
It's just that there's so many underlining stories with it. You know, with Conor McGregor, this fight is going to pay him so much that I have doubts whether or not he even want to continue fighting MMA after making that kind of money. Mm-hmm. If he were to knock him out, he's guaranteed another one of those paydays, an even bigger payday to rematch Mayweather.
Mm-hmm.
So, A, it's going to put his fighting career on the back burner because I don't think it'd be a good idea to go back and forth. So, I don't know. I mean, there is a part of me growing up as a boxing fan that wants to keep this pure and this pure.
That would also even the score, because people say, well, you saw what happened when Tony fought Couture.
Yeah, but you saw what Couture owned him. And,
right.
And Tim Sylvia.
So the boxer beat the MMA fighter in an MMA event.
Yeah.
So wouldn't it be nice to get the MMA fighter to beat the boxer in a boxing event to kind of even that score, if anyone's keeping score?
But it's different, because when you take a boxer, that's all they know, right, is the boxing, the stand-up. You can get an MMA fighter who maybe boxing isn't his. You get Damian Maia. He's one of the better fighters in UFC. Doesn't mean his stand-up's that great, right?
Right.
He's kind of on the lesser on that. So it's not always a true comparison, I think, when you do the two.
Mm-hmm.
I always feel like the boxer coming into MMA probably has the better shot than the MMA guy going into the boxing ring.
I would agree. I'll say it right now. Mayweather fights have been frustrating when he's fighting other top talent. This one might be fun because of the spectacle. Like, who's going to walk out with who? Is the Burger King guy coming out? Is Bieber coming out? Does Connor get a posse? The trash talk will be interesting. Sign me up for all that. But on fight night, I don't want to pay a dime. Why? Because it's carryover from previous Mayweather fights where I've paid my fair share. Boxing goes 70 deep. They even go 100 deep for Pacquiao. It just, I don't know. It's something about sitting there and watching the first four rounds going the same bullshit all over again.
Do you remember?
So if somebody's having a party and you have room for one more, I'm in, but I will not pay for that fight. And but I will talk about it, support it, and watch the trash talk.
Remember the movie Friday?
Yeah.
Remember when little Chris kicks over all the trash cans and he gets away and like, oh, I can't believe that little punk got us again.
Right.
That's the way I feel after every Floyd Mayweather.
Exactly.
Fight. I sit there and I go, I can't believe he got us again.
Now, anyone that says Conor's got power, fuck it, you don't think Canelo Alvarez has power? He touched him a couple times. He also missed quite a few times. Well, guess what? That's what's going to happen. He's going to miss more often than Canelo is. But guess what? His defense isn't as good as Canelo's, so the times Canelo did get hit, whether it was cumulative punching that added into a 10-9 round being scored for Mayweather or just damage, that's what's going to happen. It's even ridiculous to talk about it. To talk about the actual boxing match and what's going to happen there, I just don't see Conor getting – if it goes 10 rounds, I think it'll be exhibition, so I think it'll be a – more of an exhibition fight with 10 rounds, maybe even less. Sure, yeah, maybe he can land something. But for the most part, I don't think he's going to land much. And I think it's going to be quite comical.
You ever see
That's
when they
no disrespect to McGregor. It's just how good Mayweather is. McGregor's a beast in the sport of mixed martial arts. Inside and outside the cage, a monster. I've enjoyed covering him through Cage Warriors in the UFC. The fact that he puts himself out there and has the cojones to try and call the rounds. He's gotten most of them right, you know, and to just, I mean, he's so animated. His trash talk is legendary. Mm-hmm. All that is great, but he cannot go in there and compete against one of the best boxers of all time. He just can't do it.
Well, who's the best boxer in MMA? Who do you feel has the best hands? Because even that guy, I would still be saying the same thing. It's nothing against Conor McGregor.
Who's the MMA fighter with the best boxing?
Yeah. You take a Frankie Edgar, a Cub Swanson, they've got good boxing. Even a George Masvidal. It has nothing to do with Conor McGregor. These aren't slights at Conor.
Right.
This is just, it's just fact, guys.
Well, I would say I like George Masvidal's boxing, and he does have a boxing background. So, yeah. I mean, without going, you know, you can't say Anthony Johnson because he's just too big to fight Mayweather, but I like how you were hovering in that 45-55 range, although Masvidal's a 70 guy now. It's just a whole different ball game.
It's no different than when you hear people talk about a track and field guy. He's so fast. He should be in the NFL. He'd be a great wide receiver. Mm-hmm. Yeah, all right. He could run, but is he going to be able to cut the way a wide receiver cuts? Is he going to be able to focus on the
physicality, the
ball, knowing that somebody's about to
blocking
lay him out?
Downfield?
Can he be able to catch it? Can he block? There's so many things that people don't understand that go with boxing that don't happen in mixed martial arts.
Danny, I'm going to take Hal's call. And if you can try Valentina again, she should be in a good spot now.
I just tried her, like, less than 2 minutes ago. Still didn't get anything.
Okay. well, it said try her now. Signal is good. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll try her as soon as you go to Hal.
All right. What's up, Hal? How you doing?
Pretty good. Is that okay with you, George? Because I don't think you asked Danny what he said. You were asking him what you want him to do now.
I couldn't hear you, brother. You're kind of chopping
up.
What's up?
He's got a horrible signal.
All right.
Are you with Valentina?
You good?
Yeah.
Are you on the moon right now?
What is happening?
This is bad?
Yeah, now nah, that's better. That's good, better, yeah.
Okay, good?
Back on what you
are. Put you on hold, buddy. We're going to put you on
hold. I was just saying that, Danny's a nice guy. I want to give him the opportunity to get some on his chest, man.
Hal, if you're hearing me, I'm going to put you on hold. You got to get to
Aaron
a better era.
Too.
Aaron from Minnesota, what's up? How you doing, buddy?
Pretty good, buddy. How about you?
Good, buddy.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, buddy, let him talk. I agree with you guys as far as, like, you know, different in boxing. McGregor's not the best boxer in MMA, but you don't always have to be. I mean, I would probably say he's not the best MMA fighter in all of his fights that he's won. You know what I mean? Like,
who's that?
There's different McGregor. You know?
Really?
Like, yeah, really.
You didn't think he was the
best
MMA
fighter? I mean, I would
say
that there's probably guys he's faced that are better all-around fighters.
Mm-hmm. Think about what he's saying, George.
He has quite a strength, though, in his power, though.
If he rematched Jose Aldo today and someone put a gun to your head, where are you going to put your money?
Mm.
Right? But just the fact that you're humming right now puts a little bit of validity to what Aaron's saying. The Chad Mendes fight, had it been an eight-week camp or something like that, they said, we're going to do it again in 2 months. I'm pretty sure you would have probably still put your money on Mendes again.
Back then, I would have put it on Mendes, for sure, and Aldo.
There's a couple instances.
But now getting to him moving up to 55 and being able to handle, you know, Alvarez, and so he just continuously keeps getting better. Those two guys you described, I think, have kind of reached a peak. Mendes, if he were to come back, would have a two-year layoff. Mm-hmm. Aldo, I think, has probably the most incredible physical skills of almost any fighter ever, except up here, man. You know, something about that matchup with Connor, I just don't know. I don't know if he could hold it together and say, okay, I got to beat him over 25 minutes and show off all these skills rather than get into a firefight or you know, get one back on him, because he's not going to be able to top 13 seconds, you know, but he may be able to finish him at some point. He's going to have to live with that. But can Connor – I mean, Connor just ruffles people's feathers. He throws people off his game. I heard some Eddie Alvarez interviews lately. Same thing. Mark Henry, Eddie Alvarez, that wasn't the game plan. They just did the opposite. It was just a complete different stage that they were on, and it felt like Connor had the playbook, you know, like Connor was, you know, steps ahead of him, and that's something that I admire about that kid.
All right, let me rephrase the question.
Okay.
The best Jose Aldo versus the best Connor McGregor, who would you take?
Jose Aldo.
The best Nate Diaz versus the best Connor McGregor, who would you take?
Nate Diaz.
That's what I think the point that Aaron's making is, mm-hmm. even in some of these fights in MMA, we're still not saying he's the best guy in the fight.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But I also believe that when you get to that level, some of those differences are those intangibles. And so there would be, like, I would be sitting in that arena because my life's at stake here, thinking, did Nate Diaz train as hard as he could? Mm-hmm. And so one thing Connor doesn't seem to leave any doubt to me is that motherfucker trained. Same thing with Floyd. Like, they have all these riches and successes, but then when it's time to camp, they do it. The diet's on point, and, you know, I guess that night means so much to them that they'll put everything else, they cast it aside, and focus on that. With Jose, he'd be well-prepared, but he seems to be, you know, injured from time to time. Would he be 100%? And then mentally, where would he be? You know, would he be somewhat defeated walking in? That'd be the scary part. So you have to account for those two.
Do you remember when Michael Bisping was talking trash, and even Nick Diaz, to GSP, and he and people would ask him, like, does this ruffle your feathers? And he said, no, because I've heard this before. I hear this from every opponent. And he still goes out and does his job. Floyd Mayweather is very similar. For the people that don't like his antics outside of the ring, it doesn't mean that he doesn't show up to that gym every day and train. If you talk to the people that train with him, he's one of the hardest working athletes in that sport. I just don't see Conor doing anything that's going to ruffle those feathers.
I may take something back. I may take Conor McGregor against Jose.
Yeah?
I think so. I think I feel comfortable.
Best versus best?
I think so.
Wow.
I think so. The wrestler guys scare me a little bit more, especially the ones that have explosive doubles with, you know, grappling to accompany that. So Mendes on a 10-week camp or 8-week camp is a little scary to me. But I think I'm comfortable with Jose. I mean, Conor, man, that game is in slow motion to him. And, you know, he's making you miss, and he's exploiting. He's efficient. I don't know. Aaron, I guess we stole a little
Aaron,
bit of what you were.
Aaron, stop blabbing, man. Can you get to your point?
Yeah,
Aaron?
Sorry about that. Sorry about that, Aaron. Start from scratch, I guess.
That's okay. Because while you guys were talking, you both kind of made my point. Despite him not always being the best fighter all around, he has these intangibles. One of them, like you said, is mental game. He knows how to get a guy to just throw the plan out the window and get into his game. Mm-hmm. And another thing is, he doesn't need to be the best fighter for 5 minutes in a round. He just needs to be the best fighter for a 30-second period, and then the fight's over. So those are the things I see in MMA. Now, whether that's going to carry over to boxing, of course not. He's going to lose, obviously, because he's not the best boxer, but I don't care. I'm going to watch it because it's a spectacle. I'm going to love the buildup, and I'm going to love sitting there watching. Am I going to pay $70? No, but come on, George. If someone's going to order it, you won't throw in $15. I mean, you can't even get a burger and fries for that.
Yeah, if you're putting me on the spot like that, I'm not going to do that to a homie. Hey, there's three of us. You want to chip in, you know? But me sitting by myself, you know, Goz is out of town. I'm not going to pay. That's just how strongly I feel about it. I don't want to give any more money to someone who hasn't entertained me. Now, I'm talking about the Mayweather side. Yeah, I just don't need to. I can honestly can look you guys in the eye, Dwayne, to my right, Goz, the camera, and say, I don't even have to watch it. I don't have to. I will. I probably will, but I'd be okay with if I had someone's birthday or a wedding. I don't need to run to my phone. I don't need to break away or nothing. I've been taught that lesson by Mayweather many times. The buildup, I'm in. I even want to go to the in person to the weigh-ins, to the press conferences, anything like that, I'm in. That is entertainment to me, but the boxing match, you watch. The boxing match is going to be a yawner.
You know how they're going to catch me, though?
Unless Mayweather or McGregor headbutts them and then just, you know, chairs start flying, something like that. Something, an anomaly like that, yeah. But a boxing match, you just watch. I'm telling you.
When I was a young Ghost and you were a young George, I vividly remember this. We were playing football outside on the front lawn, playing catch. And our dad goes, hey, we're going to go over Jim's house, which is our neighbor across the street. Mm-hmm. We're going to watch Mike Tyson versus Buster Douglas.
Right.
We said, who? He said, Buster Douglas, the guy that's fighting Mike Tyson. And we maybe threw a couple more rounds, and then we said, nah, let's just go. And we went. Being able to witness that live was incredible. And I have a lot of friends who passed up on that, and I don't want to be that guy. So that's probably how you are going to hook me in. But you're gonna have to hook me in with a bunch of buddies.
Well, that was you walking
by myself.
You walked across the street to a free viewing. Yeah. Big Jim didn't ask us for money. So again, something like that. All right, cool. And yeah, Aaron, if a homie says, hey, this is the way it is, I'm obviously not gonna go, no, you know, whatever. But right now, that's my stance. I just have no interest.
All right, I'll take this off air because you bring up Tyson. The first fight that I saw live was, and I'm just tailing along with my dad to some dude's house, was Tyson versus Spinks. What was the first fight you guys saw live?
Yeah, that was like
live. Thanks for the call.
He probably means like pay-per-view, right?
I can't remember. Oh, no. Okay, here's one that just stood out to me was Duran and Leonard in Montreal. It was like 1980. Mm-hmm. So that's one. Other than like dad saying that's Muhammad Ali and me going oh, you know, and then going back to playing because I was a little kid, like one where I sat down and like was watching the build up, the walkouts, because I could correlate Sugar Ray winning the gold medal in 1976 for us. In fact, it was in Montreal, and Roberto Duran was just that Latino fighter that Latinos were like, that's our guy. So the fact that Duran chirped, you know, Leonard won the gold medal, I was split. I didn't know what to do. But I remember watching that fight, and I think it was at dad's friend's house or something like that. And that's like one that registers. Again, throwing out the old me, just walking in and seeing what dad's up to, him watching a fight and walking out, like not really paying attention to the whole thing. That would be it. How about you?
I remember watching Wild World of Sports. I can't remember who it was, but Leonard did fight, and I remember watching
on Wild World of Sports. Yeah. Okay. Now, in the 80s on CBS, I saw Arguello, Livingstone Bramble, Aaron Pryor, Mancini, Kim. CBS Sports was the shit back in the day. But Leonard Duran was the first mega fight for me. All right, you're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93. This will give us a few minutes to try and get Valentina Shevchenko on the show. She's saying she's got coverage where she's at.
Mm-hmm.
Danny's saying he can't get through, so we'll have to sort this out one way or another. I've invited them to just call in from wherever they're at, and that should settle it.
Sam All Jam just chimed in. His first fight was David and Goliath. This is his first big mega pay-per-view.
All right, we'll be right back after this break.
Hey, idiot. Yeah, you. Can you please tap that rather large fellow on the shoulder and tell him it's time for more MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Goes? Thank you.
I'll be the rather large fellow if you want to be the idiot that taps me on the shoulder. All right. Quick shout out to Dwayne
on the camera. All you see is an arm.
Regina from Oklahoma City, hanging out here in Vegas, doing one of their, I wouldn't say yearly trips, annual trips, because they come here more than once per year. But great to see you guys. Hopefully you'll be here for the gathering too. Or
oh yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. One fight that just got added to the recently announced UFC Fight Night 112 card is Ilir Latifi, a.k.a. Queen Latifah, versus Antonio Rogerio, excuse me, Nogueira, Little Nog. Added to that recently was BJ Penn versus Dennis Seaver, Tim Boach versus Johnny Hendricks, Felice Herrig versus Justine Kish, Jeremy Kimball versus Josh Stansberry. So off to a good start there. All right, joining us now is UFC bantamweight Valentina Shevchenko. Hi, Valentina. How are you?
Hello, George. I'm fine. And you?
Good. Thank you. Thanks for joining us here again on the MMA Junkie Radio Show. I got Goz with me as well. We're happy to have you. Valentina, it looks like you had some nice R&R, rest and relaxation out in Hawaii.
Yeah, we have a very good trip. My sister Antonina, her fight and land fight, it was canceled because of her opponent could not make medical commissions. That's why we rescheduled our itinerary. If we went to Hawaii, it was very beautiful and nice there.
Yeah, I saw you went fishing and hiking and just got to enjoy the beautiful Hawaiian weather. But what was the biggest fish you caught?
It was big tuna, and it was very, very beautiful fishing. It's very, amazing experience. I really enjoy, and we caught, each one for a few fishes, and then we make very, traditional dish of Hawaii. It's named poke from tuna fish. I like it, and since then, it's one of our favorite dishes.
Mm. I was wondering if any of that was going to turn into some Peruvian ceviche. You know how to prepare that one?
For sure, for sure. We know how to prepare ceviche. We know how to prepare chupe de camarones.
Yeah.
And we try to collect different dishes from different places over the whole world. And then when we meet with our friends, we're trying to surprise them.
Because have you noticed that Valentina is able to learn almost anything? Because if you watch her on the social media, she's doing the fishing, and it looked like you only have to explain it once, and she's good.
Yeah.
Same thing with the ceviche. She probably didn't have to get many lessons there. But what I noticed it was on that trip to JBLE, and they were showing her, as far as how to take apart a gun and put it together, and then shoot the stuff. Even the stuff that she knew, she was just adding to the knowledge. So you have a very good ability to listen and take in the information and put it to practice. You don't need very many lessons.
Yes, this is what I and especially all the things I very like to do it, especially with the guns, because we are competing with Antonina and in defensive shooting. That's why all these things about guns, about training with the guns, I really enjoy doing it. That's why when I see something new, I very open for new experiences.
Like if I owned a bar and I had a lot of money and Valentina was done fighting, I bet you I could turn her into the best bartender. I'd say, here's how you make
20 minutes.
Here's how you make 20 different drinks, and she would get it. And by the end of the night, it would be a clean bar. The tip bar would be full. Obviously, if we have any problems, she can defend herself. Mm-hmm. But I really feel like you can teach her almost anything.
No, I totally agree with that. Yeah. I feel like at the base, if they said,
George, why it's never happened?
Why?
Because I very put everything for. My spirit in there, only in things what I enjoy and I really love. It's like martial arts, guns, dancing, kitchen, cuisine, different like this. That's why I really put myself in there and trying every time to be better and better. But some things that I not enjoy like this, I maybe will pass it.
Oh, okay. All right.
There you go.
Well, all right. So here's how I want to tie everything in. Okay. Because when we were interviewing Valentina, and she heard it from other outlets as well, people kept saying, what about the ground game? What about the ground game? What about the ground game? And she kept saying, I'm a complete martial artist. If you looked at Valentina's record, she didn't have very many submissions as of late. But again, going back to if you're teaching or something and she's training in it, guess what? It may happen in the fight, whether it's a new attack with a spinning elbow or you know something to do with the ground or a judo throw. It may be played out. And what that's called is, have you heard of people that have photographic memory?
Yeah.
Okay. Her and BJ Penn. BJ Penn's another guy I've heard that have what's called photographic memory, but to do with not like remembering an image or a word or anything like that, but remembering some sort of
a sequence.
A sequence, right? A physical sequence. You don't have to teach them many times, and they get that. I think that's what Valentina has. I don't know if that's ever been proven, but I know BJ Penn's another guy. You can teach him. This is how you throw a jab, and he'll be throwing a jab that night perfectly.
No, I think you said it perfectly. I completely agree. I feel like on the base when we were seeing those helicopters or the Raptor. If she would have just went, how's this work again? She would have been taken off like in 30 minutes.
Exactly. Yeah. So,
you know, George, also I can tell you about the ground game. I was doing MMA since like 2002. But the reason, like I was explaining, and every time I tell them, from 2002 till 2006, I was very active in competing in MMA and Muay Thai. And that time I had a lot of like victories by submission. But the reason why I didn't compete since 2006, it was very difficult to find opponent. And that's why we was focused more in like striking in stand up game. But since 2010, we again start to compete in MMA and Muay Thai together. That's why in UFC, people, like before the last fight, they couldn't see my fights on the ground. But it's every time it doesn't matter that I don't do it. It was just the right moment, right place. And that's why this is the reason. It's not like I learned some techniques in 1 year and it's technique work. It was not like this because I do MMA many years. I started to do it many years ago.
Valentina Shevchenko, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio. All right, goes. What do you have for Valentina?
Well, Valentina, we just spent about 5 minutes talking about the things that you're really good at. Can you share something? Because I was even thinking, like, when we went bowling, was she bad? But no, she was good at that, too.
She's pretty good
so
at that.
So what is there something out there that you're not good at that you – not because you don't like doing it, but just because you're just not good at it?
Really, and bowling, it was my very first time to play in this game. It was the first time my practice.
Wow, she beat me too.
She beat you?
Yeah. I feel worse.
Can you play instruments? Can you play the piano or anything?
A few time ago, since we was first time when we was to travel on the travel to Hawaii for the first time, it was in 2014. And I really enjoy and I really like ukulele, Hawaiian guitar. And since then, I start to practice like a little bit. I cannot put all my time to practice playing ukulele because of training, everything. But like step by step, I'm learning to play ukulele and for now, it's everything good, and in future, I hope I will do it in perfection.
Very cool. Valentina, let's talk a little bit about Amanda Nunes. In the last fight, a lot of people felt like at the end of the fight, the last round, you won that round. Do you feel like you're carrying that momentum into this next fight?
It will be not only this moment, it will be everything. Since that fight, I spent a lot of time like training and changing my plan games, changing my rhythm for MMA fights. So, and each fight that I spent after the fight with Amanda, with Holly, and with Juliana, it's make me more stronger. That's why it will be totally different, and it will be a very good fight because I will put all my heart on that. To win it and do everything like the best that I can.
Do you feel that she's changed a lot since the last time you guys have fought as a fighter?
I think for each people, like each experience, it's made change. That's why maybe yes, but it's difficult to say because all her fights, it was ending very fast, and we could not see a lot of fights. But what I can say, it's very dangerous opponent. That's why I have to train in triple times more, and I will do it because it doesn't matter. I was fighting every time with the best ones, and this is like what I want, and I want this title, and I will do everything to win it.
After your last fight, they brought Amanda into the cage, and you had the opportunity to look into her eyes. And at times, it seemed like she was very emotional, very upset. Can you maybe talk a little bit about how you interpreted her emotions that night?
Oh, that night, it's difficult to analyze this because it was after my victory. And this was like emotion inside me. Like after every victory that you can have, you're feeling so great, so high. That's why like nothing can stop you. And but I think it was very good because when she was in the octagon inside, I knew that it will be done. Our next fight, it will be for sure. So it's just a matter of time and date.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. You had heard they were going to fight, that you two were going to fight possibly in April, and then that fight didn't happen. And then recently she tweeted that she would like to fight you in Rio de Janeiro in early June, I think June 3rd, which would be UFC 212. And you replied to her, hey, it didn't happen in April, which is, you know, that was, I guess, one opportunity that was presented to both of you. And so now you've made plans. You kind of readjusted your life in terms of, you know, personal things, vacations and family, friends, stuff like that. So it sounds like you declined the one in Brazil. So my next question would be, it sounds like July is what you were saying. Have you heard anything since then?
You know, like when she declined this fight in April, she was saying to UFC that she will be out for like some time and she will not back till July, so, like all this stuff. And of course, I was planning my itinerary, everything, my schedule, to be busy before the July. But then she changed her mind, and now we are speaking about the date. And I think soon we will have something. But I think my manager Roger, her managers, they are speaking with UFC, and soon we will have a date, and we both will put all our power in the training, and we'll do a very great fight together.
When do you want to fight?
Anytime in July, I'm ready. Anytime.
Okay. Now, in July, there's International Fight Week here in Las Vegas. There's three fight cards back-to-back-to-back at the T-Mobile Arena. So that's one opportunity. And then in California, in Anaheim, California, there's a pay-per-view as well. That's July 29th. Do you have any preference towards early part of July in Vegas or later part of July, possibly in California?
For me, all July is good. That's why not much preference. I think it will be great. It doesn't matter where, because the fight, it's the fight. And I not focus on the place. I'm focused on the opponent.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and then talk to me a little bit about Peru. You know, we know that MMA is growing out there. We know that you live part-time out there as well. And I wanted to ask you, Kevin Lee's doing a press tour. He's a UFC lightweight. I'm not sure if you know who he is, but he's in Detroit right now doing some press because the UFC is rumored to go out to Detroit. Max Holloway, every time we have him on the show, he's always talking about the UFC needs to come to Hawaii. How about you? If you had your choice, have you heard anything about the UFC ever going to Peru, or would you want to fight in Peru, in Lima, Peru?
You know, I'm not sure that it will happen because still it's very difficult, and especially now for Peru it's very difficult time because of this El Corriente Niño, mm-hmm. And Peru is suffering a lot of like raining. And all my best wishes for all families, for all people of Peru. And I every time like look in the news and hoping that everything will be good, and I know everything will be good, and with all my emotion, with all my spirit, I send into Peru for all single person and vision there, like all the best. And of course, Peru is a very good country and very beautiful country. It's a lot of beautiful place there, and it will be interesting someday.
I think so too, because you know Brazil's been great for Latin America, but I feel like one of the other countries now needs to get a show. I had heard Chile was going to get a show in 2017, but there hasn't been a date pop up. I know they filmed The Ultimate Fighter, Latin America, in Argentina one year, so I thought maybe they'd maybe they'd go back there, but that hasn't happened. And now, you know, if you think about it, you're Peruvian, Kenny Florian's Peruvian, Tony D'Souza, who was he fought many years ago, he's Peruvian. George Masvidal is half Peruvian as well. Mm-hmm. And then
Luis
Palomino's Peruvian. So there's quite a few Peruvian fighters. And even the one, Barzola, I forget his name, the guy that won Latin America years ago. There's a couple Peruvians as well. And even Gaston Bolanos and the other kid that we saw at Lion Fight, his protege, they're Peruvian. Gaston's not fighting for Bellator. But my point is, Peru's producing a lot of combat sports athletes. So I think they really could do something in Lima. Lima's a huge hub in Latin America. It sure would be nice to see that.
Let's see in the future. I think all is possible. It's all in the hand of the UFC. That's why let's see how it's turned out.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. All right. Well, I guess, are you technically on vacation right now? Should we say go back to enjoying your vacation, or what are you doing now? Have you started a mini camp?
This is, all people say like, okay, Valentina, you're in Hawaii, you're in vacation. But it's not like this, because this is my lifestyle. A lot of traveling to go here, there, explore places, explore everything. This is how I used to live every time. And this was like trip to Hawaii. We was there. We was going there to the gym. We was training there. We spent a very good time on the beach and make life complete. That's why for me it's not like I was training, and then one time, okay, I'm in vacation. No, this is my lifestyle, and I really enjoy to have this kind of life, to have this opportunity to make travels, to meet new people, to meet new places, and every time to find any place where I can train in and do any sparring or roll with some new opponents, new sparring partners. It's every time very good for your level. It's make you a little bit better every time.
Very cool. Well, I hope to see you in July, either in Vegas or in California. I have a feeling it'll be one of those. And thank you so much for doing the interview, as always.
George, the most important thing that after the Hawaii, we went to Los Angeles, and then I met my favorite fighter of all time.
Oh, Benny.
Benny the Jet Orchidus.
Benny, yeah.
Yes.
I saw that.
It was my, I wanted to do it during many, many years, because every time when people was asking who is your favorite fighter, every time it's Benny the Jet Orchidus. And finally I could see him, I could shake his hand, we had lunch. So it was very, very good month for me, very filled with very good emotions, very good energy, and with this kind of energy, I'm ready to start my training camp and put all my heart and everything for next fight and do all my best.
Well, congratulations. That's great that you got to see him, and I did see that on Instagram, so that's very cool. All right, Valentina, well, thank you very much for the time, and we can't wait to see your next fight against Amanda Nunes sometime this summer.
Thank you very much, George. Thank you very much, girls, and hope to see you soon sometime. And that time in GBLE, it was a great time. I hope in the future we will have more trips like this.
For sure. Count on it. Take care. Say hello to Pavel and your sister and Roger and everybody.
Sure, I will. Thank you.
Take care.
Have
Bye-bye.
A good day.
Follow her on Twitter, folks, at Bullet Valentina. Let her know you heard her on the @MMAJunkie Radio Show. We'll be right back to close up shop.
do what they say, your life will be a lot better. Here are Gorgeous and Goes.
Well, that's a bummer. We dropped Hal. Or he dropped, sorry, I should say.
Oh, well.
We were going to end the show with Hal from Chicago, who patiently waited. I just couldn't understand him. He kept breaking up on the first try, so.
I think we should still kind of give him half a cheer, right? 2, 4, 6, 8.
Who do we appreciate? Noble's Kitchen and Bath. Noble's Kitchen and Bath. Noble's Kitchen and Bath.
Yay! I think I called them Noble's Kitchen and Gas.
I heard that. Yeah. I heard that the first time. All right. Thank you to our guests, John Gunderson and John Wood. Thanks to Gunderson for setting up, getting John Wood in here, and, of course, himself. Thanks to Valentina Shevchenko, Roger, for the assist there. Tomorrow we'll be joined in studio by Megan Alevi from the UFC and Fox Sports. She'll be co-hosting with us. And I'm sure we'll have another guest or two. Still working on that yet, so I can't release the names. Don't want to jinx it. And thanks to the callers that called in and everybody that participates via social media. I try and get in there as much as I can, even if it's post-show, to answer some questions. So if you ever leave us questions, I'll gladly answer them to the best of my ability, whether it has to do with the show or content during the show. For example, somebody had asked, when's Boss Rudin come on? You know, and or I think they thought he would be in studio. If you go to MMAjunkie.com's front page, it'll usually tell you who's in studio and who isn't. Maybe we could be a little more specific with the time, so I'll try to include that for the editorial, or possibly goes when he's filling all that out on Facebook. Anyway, we'll tackle all that another time. For now, I want to say thank you on behalf of Danny and Goes, and I'm George, and we'll see you tomorrow. Go out there and be champions.